Okay, so let me begin by thanking the organizers inviting me to this very memorable event. So before my beginning my talk, let me just mention that the Spenta's we heard and I also mentioned that his leading role, especially in Asia countries, including Korea. So as you may see here, among the researchers, in this example, APHTP, the number of Indian researchers are increasing, keep increasing, and the time that it starts actually increasing is coincident with his time that he takes the position of the Science Council member. So, and also, in other institutes in Korea, Sequest, we have had many Indian, very excellent Indian researchers. We are very happy about that. And also, as well as the long-term visitors, and as well as many, too many to list in this page. Okay, let me begin my presentation. The thing is mainly about the black hole stability. There can be many approaches, perturbative, non-perturbative. In the non-perturbative, there may be many ways. But my goal is to focus on some the thermodynamic property, including some type of black hole when we have some higher curvature terms. Because Einstein gravity is only the leading term, and we may have actually some higher order curvature terms. So as a simplest example, I'd like to see what kind of property if we have some extra term in the higher curvature, and also its implication, although I may not mention in this presentation. Okay. About the stability, here we saw the last year that actually the two black holes are merging into one, sending out part of the energy into gravitational wave. So one of the questions one can say is that whether this is irreversible process or it could be sometimes reversible. In other words, if it were reversible, some single black hole may be split into two black holes. Definitely, if it is possible, it is not perturbative, and it is a highly non-perturbative aspect. So that's what I'd like to study. And of course, I mean, I don't have to mention all the things. The stability or instability of the black holes are deeply related to the quantum field theory through the holography. And also, the black holes in higher dimensions are quite diverse as quantum field theory also. Okay, so let me begin by considering the theory with the Gauss-Bonnet theory. So we have some complicated action. The first term is the simple Einstein plus the simple Dilaton coupling. And here we have the Gauss-Bonnet coupling. In the four dimension, of course, this is topological. So we, in general, it may couple to the Dilaton also here. So in this action, of course, due to this coupling, we lost the translation symmetry of the scalar, the Dilaton field phi. But still, we have the reflection symmetry of the phi if we also reflect the coupling gamma. So due to this, only the sign signature of the gamma is physical, so we may choose it positive. Another thing is the general coupling strength of this L, which I wrote here is alpha. So this can be scaled out by rescaling the distance. So in other words, we could put alpha equal to 1. However, in this case, we cannot easily continue to the alpha equal to 0 limit, which is to the Einstein limit. So we will just keep alpha in this analysis, even though we can always get rid of that. So we have more complicated equations of motion. So the typical energy, in addition to the typical energy momentum tensor, there are some extra pieces coming from the Gauss-Bonnet coupling. So one thing, even before solving the solution numerically, one thing one may notice is that there is no black hole without any hair. Or in other words, every black hole in this model should carry hair. It can be easily seen because no hair solution which corresponds to phi, dilaton phi equal to identically zero, it is inconsistent with this equation of motion, as you can see here. If phi is identically zero, as long as alpha is not zero, this term vanishes, and that means Gauss-Bonnet term should be zero, and which is not true. So, in other words, every black hole solution in this model should carry hair. That's one thing. Another thing is that the, as the coupling goes to vanishing, then we get back to the Schwarzschild solution. And also as a special case for this gamma coupling, if it is zero, the coupling in front of the Gauss-Bonnet term becomes constant, making this term as a topological. So that's some special Einstein-Gauss-Bonnet theory. So that's another special limit. Okay, so then we can easily do it by power series expansion that the solution will have, in addition to constant piece, they should carry one of our term in the dilaton. So as we see here, the dilaton charge is not zero. However, it is also not independent. In other words, once the mass is determined, then black hole charge, the hair charge will also be determined. Okay, that's the general property. Now, as for the solution here, so we plot it in terms of the, it's a rescaled by rescaling, so rescaled radial distance versus rescaled dilaton. So dilaton, as you see, is not identically zero. It's almost zero outside of some region, asymptotic region. However, near the horizon, of course, it is not zero. So that's why it is hair. So as you see here, black hole horizon becomes So that means so R tilde is essentially the horizon. So the horizons are so related to mass. So there is some minimum mass for given coupling. Then for any larger masses or the larger black holes, there is a solution. So as you see here, we may choose some special line, let's say, the blue line. As we make a black hole larger and larger going outside, that means a larger black hole, then the dilaton field is becoming smaller and smaller. So in other words, the horizon becomes larger, then the scalar field becomes smaller. And so in other words, roughly speaking, large size black hole is the asymptotical to the Schwarzschild black hole. That's the property of this theory. To show more detail, for given parameter, you may see that this is the horizon and this is the mass. So, there is a two-branch solution. In other words, here are many things we can mention. For large size heavy black holes, there is only one branch. But in some region of the black hole mass, there are two branches of solutions. It turns out that this is very unstable branch, and while this is perturbatively stable branch. So in other words, in these regions, large size black holes are stable, while small size black hole is unstable. And another thing is the existence of this point. So below this mass, there is no solution at all. So in other words, there exists minimum mass. That's another property. Also, if we change the parameter gamma smaller, then this branch S point is getting closer to C, as you see here, and eventually disappear. So only single branch appears. So that eventually it will approach to the Schwarzschild black hole limit. So that's the general property. So this shows a little bit more detail about the relation between the horizon and the mass in terms of this hair. Of course, if it were Schwarzschild black hole, mass and the horizon is the same in some appropriate unit, but that appears only very large mass case. And but for smaller masses, the horizon and the mass relation is more complicated. Now, our question is, how about the properties of this black hole, so stability, and also the an implication to cosmology, etc. So that's what we have studied, and here we'll mention only some stability issues in this talk. Okay, so as for the stability, one may study perturbatively, one non-perturbatively. In the non-perturbative way, there can be so many ways of approach. What I'd like to, what we have done is like, I mean, we send some particle and see it will be absorbed into the black hole. Then we just analyze in such case whether there can, it may trigger any instability. That's one thing. Another thing is whether it can be actually fragmented. It's a highly non-perturbative thing. Okay, so just as a brief review, the typical perturbative stability check is that we are given some background configuration of the black hole, then perturb of the any fields or the metric, then eventually the linear approximation level or the stability equations ends up to this kind of Schrodinger-like type equations, and then by analyzing some of these quasi normal modes, whether there is any some growing modes, then that's the signal of the instability. So that the in the four-dimensional case, there are many nice review of papers. And to make it very simple, we may say that most of the four-dimensional black holes are stable, even though some extreme core or Rison Nordstrom, that case could be unstable. So that's a general thing. And also for the higher dimension, many things are known. But as we mentioned, there we have many variety of the black holes in such case. And the, also the new type of this instability also occurs. Now, our question is whether, I mean, we could also go beyond this some perturbative this stability. So here, as you may have seen many other papers here, if we just draw, for example, in the higher dimensions, this is spinning, and this is the area of the horizon. Then, so let's, as an example, let's take this black line. Then here, this is the topologically, the topology of the horizon is the sphere case. So as it rotates faster and faster here, this direction, then the shape is becoming flattened, and the area is becoming here, as you see here, smaller. Or in other words, entropy is becoming smaller compared to other type of ring type or Saturn type or many more rings and with the Saturns, et cetera, et cetera. So roughly speaking, we may say that in high dimension, slowly rotating black holes may prefer the spherical topology of the horizon, while in a fast rotating black hole, the horizon may be more, I mean, the, it's flattened and so just make more and more rings. That's the some qualitative aspects. Okay, so another way is that in the ADS black hole case in higher dimension, there exists some region, unlike the flat case, there can exist some region where ADS or rotating black hole or black hole can be unstable under super radius. Okay? Those are well known. Now, what I'd like to show here is, of course, what happens if we just introduce some particle there. So particle goes into the black hole. In such case, I just dropped all the equations as much as possible and wrote down only part of the results. Then by this one, the black hole entropy is increasing. It's not clear from these pictures, I mean, in this expression, because I even didn't show the definition of many of these symbols. But physically, such thing depends on the radial momenta. If the particle just goes through the radial direction, there is the maximum radial momenta, and if it rotates fast and then spirals, then the, even given with the same energy, the radial component of momenta will be different. So we can actually calculate the change of the mass of the black hole after absorption of the particle or the entropy by relating that to the radial component of the black hole. So for the rotating black hole, the absorbed particle may have the same direction rotation or the opposite direction rotation. So we studied both cases and in the higher dimensions. So the in other words, this one is core black hole case, or let's say in the higher dimensional rotating black hole, Meyer Perry black holes, with only single rotation turned on. But the, we could also study in higher dimensional rotating black hole with a multi rotation turned on. A case we study is only the two values of angular momenta, A values and the B values. Then the conclusion is similarly, we can relate the change of the entropy in terms of the all the radial component of the momenta of the particle. So to make it short, always the entropy is increasing, but the, we have to be somewhat careful about the mass of the black hole. So there is some irreducible part, and so we have to be careful in defining that. So depending on the rotation, that apparent mass may be changing, either increasing or decreasing. However, entropy is always increasing. That's what we figured out. Now, moving to the somewhat non-portable instability based on the, some fragmentation analysis. The thermodynamic the analysis means nothing but comparing the entropy before the splitting and after the splitting. So then, if the splitted configuration has higher the entropy, we may say that that is thermodynamically preferred, and we do not calculate the transition rate here. But however, if such thing possible, then the this may be suggest some instability. So here, this is each line is kind of some summary of the papers. In the case of Meyer Perry black holes, we found that by that kind of analysis, so of course, a Meyer Perry black hole in higher dimension, unlike the four dimensional case, the angular momentum usually do not have any upper bound. But anyway, in such even in such case, for large angular momentum case, according to our analysis, such Meyer Perry black holes may become unstable on the fragmentation. Also, similarly for the charged black hole also. So, finally mention about this the case with the Gauss-Bonnet theory. So, the we introduced a delta parameter, which is nothing but the ratio. So the mass split into delta and the one minus delta. So delta is the fraction. So the if we just choose the smaller size one, then the delta will be a very light one or could be just carrying half of the original mass. So that's the delta parameter. So as a warm up, the black hole case, if we compare naively the initial single black hole versus the final black hole that split into delta and the one minus delta of the original mass. Then, as you see here, it's always smaller than one. So that means final split configuration is not preferred. So shortest black hole is absolutely stable under fragmentation. Okay, so with this exercise, we may think about some Einstein Gauss Bonnet theory, which corresponds to M equals zero case, and then to just make it simple. So we are interested in the region where the final configuration entropy is bigger than the initial configuration. Maybe very hard to see here, but what we see here is that if we compare the, let me just move on to the dilaton Gauss Bonnet theory also. First, go to the next one, the dilaton Gauss Bonnet theory. That will be the what I wanted to say. So here, it's a full expression. It's a very complicated. So essentially, the final two black hole configuration versus initial single black hole entropy ratio. We can write down in terms of the all the parameters in the theory. And the, of course, even though the expression is looks like very complicated, if we take the large black hole size limit, which is to the short black hole limit, we can see that the final black hole is actually the entropy smaller, so that the they do not fragment. So in other words, the black hole large size black hole is usually the stable, even with the Gauss Bonnet coupling. However, if the mass is not that large, then there can be some parameter range. That's what we'd like to show here. So for example here, it's not clear to see here, so we just blow up, for example, this region, it's 1 point something people, and so if we increase that's about the, this region, then still not clear, so we just blow up once more. Then, as you may see here, first, blue line is for the gamma equals zero case as a reference, and the red line is actually the for the non-zero gamma case. So, so the solid one is the initial state, dotted one is the final state. So, as you see here, they are crossing. In other words, this smaller size black hole case and the large size black hole case, there's splitting. The values are changed. So in the large size black hole, the dotted line, which is a two black hole state, entropy is smaller than the solid red line, which is the single initial black hole entropy. So it's roughly speaking, large size black hole is stable, while in the smaller region here, that is one, split one, has a higher the entropy. In other words, they are preferred by entropy. So the, that means so we, so there's some value under which the black hole mass is below that, then it becomes unstable. So that's the quite a drastic effect. So here we change the parameters, but the similar things keep happening. So I don't have to save the time. Just, I mean, I don't repeat that. And here, so we can just think about some phase diagram of the black holes on the stability. As we mentioned, when we see alpha, because of the scale properties, this may be redundant, so we may just think about some single alpha value is enough in terms of the phase. So usually, we mentioned that there is some minimum mass. In other words, the Gauss Bonnet term does not allow two small black holes. So it's like a kind of intuitively kind of repelling property. So only if the critical mass the black hole's mass is bigger than some critical mass, they can really collapse into a black hole. So that's represented here. And the, here, the stable region can be classified by mass or the entropy. But the, usually, so only the stable regions. But there can be some, in some parameters, small gamma values. As you see here, we see some unstable region appearing here. So the for the small size black holes, so have a large size black hole or heavy black holes, they are stable. But some smaller black holes, there is some window that the black hole becomes unstable. So that's another diagram, essentially. So that's if we just think about some region, the important thing is that there is some parameter range in the phase space that makes the black hole unstable. So this region didn't show up in the Einstein gravity, but shows up as a result of Dilaton gravity. Okay, so that's what I wanted to say. So I try to convey you that among others, the Gauss-Bonnet term. So it's comparing to the Einstein case, there's a minimum mass so that the it does not like, I mean, the collapsing for the two small size black holes. And also for the stability, they affect also the instability. They are triggering some instability. So it's a kind of not really hard binding. So that's the roughly the aspects of the Gauss-Bonnet term to the black holes. And the, finally, also even, so we also mentioned that the, another study of the biparticle absorption probe. Here, even though we haven't mentioned, we simply dropped. So the, we also studied the implication of such higher curvature terms to the cosmology in the early universe, such as inflation. Okay, that's what I wanted to say. And I want to congratulate Spenta once again, and thank you very much.
Questions?
So this theory, does it have any ghosts or something like that?
Because of the higher curvature.
Yes.
So at least, I mean, the, for the four-dimension coupling constant case, no ghost, right? But for generically, we have not studied that detail. So that I cannot answer.
Yes, means that in this theory, gravity kind of became repulsive,
right,
at small distance. Because the black hole fragments, that often happens when there are ghosts and ghosts contribute in the negative energy. I'm not sure about that point, but if you take a generic higher derivative gravity, sometimes this happens because of ghosts, but maybe not.
Okay, so still it's a very complicated, I mean, the analysis, so we don't know that part, but thanks for the comment.
Any other question? Okay. If not, let's thank Professor Lee again.